So in terms of integration, again, following the theme, if we have an integral like, but the integral from 1 to infinity of 1 over dx over x squared, something like this, so maybe you vaguely remember that this actually makes sense. This is, we have some graph like that, and we're asking about the area under that curve as all the way out to infinity, and we make sense of this by writing it as the limit as m goes to infinity of the integral from 1 to m dx over x squared, which this is all fine. So that will be the integral of 1 over x squared is minus 1 over x, evaluated from 1 to m. So that will be minus 1 over m minus the minus 1 over 1. Now we take the limit as m goes to infinity, and we get 0 plus 1, so that's 1. So the area under this curve, no matter how far we go out, it gets closer and closer and closer. So this says that as we go out further and further and further, the area under this curve tends to 1. So it makes sense to say that the value of this is 1. Right? And similarly, if we try the other end, dx over x squared, let me just use the same integral, and this would be the limit as, let's call it L for lower. So this blows up when x is 0, so we can't just evaluate it directly, but we write it as a limit. So this is the integral from L to 1 of dx over x squared, which is the limit as L goes to 0 of minus 1 over 1 plus 1 over L. And as L goes to 0, this blows up. So this is infinity, which is saying that this part of the area here is too big. Right, there's an infinite amount of area here, whereas here it shrinks very fast. Naturally, if we change this 2 to a half, and this 2 to a half, the roles will be reversed. This will be infinite, and this will be finite. Right? So everybody kind of sort of remembers that from when you did calculus 2 or whatever name it had when you did it. So now we want to make sense of the same process in integrals with more than one dimension. So say we have something like the integral, let me write it symbolically, over the unit disk of dA over about x squared plus y squared to the 1/2 power. So what does that mean? So here the unit disk is the set of x, y, such that x squared plus y squared is less than or equal to 1. Well, that's the open disk. And so I'm not parameterizing this as a specific thing. So this surface, f of x, equals 1 over x squared plus y squared square root, is something the graph of this is going to be, well, I'll cut it off. Something like that. This is sitting under the unit circle. Right? So it's a, it really goes up to infinity. I cut it off. Okay? So it'll be some horn shape where the place you would blow the horn is very far up. So this is, I guess this is a trumpet for an angel to blow. It's way up high. So the question is, does it make sense to describe the volume here? And The process is exactly the same, but we have to take a little bit more care because really the way we're going to do this is let's let, I don't know, d sub delta be the set of points in the plane where x squared plus y squared is between delta and 1. So in the plane, we're looking at this region, this annulus. That's what it's really called, an annulus. This annular region here, this ring. So if you speak Spanish, then it makes perfect sense because in Spanish this is an anillo. We don't use that word so much in English. Anyway, so we're going to integrate over this, and then we're going to let delta go to 0. Right? So we would define, if this makes sense, then this should be limit as delta goes to 0 of this function. And now we want to make sense of that. So we can either, well, since this is nice and circular and everything, it would make sense to integrate this in polar coordinates. Right? I think so anyway. Of course, you can do this. You can parameterize this as y equals square root 1 minus x squared here. And y equals minus square root 1 minus x squared here. It's just horrible, though, right? Because you'd have to split it up into several little bits, and yuck. But in polar coordinates, it's very easy. So let's just do it in polar coordinates. This region is just r is between delta 1 and theta goes from 0 to 2 pi. And so the region we want to integrate over is just that. And then we have to write this in polar coordinates. So this would be, well, I guess it's here. If we parameterize this in polar coordinates, let's let theta go from 0 to 2 pi and r go from delta 1, take the limit as delta goes to 0. dA is r dr d theta. This is r squared. R is positive, so the square root of r squared is just r. Yeah, so this becomes really easy. So this is r, that's r, it's gone. So then that integral, when we integrate with r, we get a factor of delta, and then delta d theta integrated d theta is 2 pi, so we get the limit. Something's wrong. What did I do wrong? Somehow I was just thinking it was 2 pi delta, and I was shocked that it was coming out to be 0, but it's not, which is 2 pi. So the area, the volume of this horn is 2 pi. So the analogy between the one variable improper integrals, I guess these are called improper integrals, analogy between the one variable case and the multivariable case is exactly the same. You just have to take care to realize that your limit has to be coming in from all directions. So you have to take care that your limit is as a little disk or a sphere, if you're in higher dimensions, which shrinks down to the point where you blow up. Okay? Yeah?
But if you had only one dimension shrink, the other one stayed constant, couldn't that also have finite volume? Because you just have,
like, say that again?
Like, what if you had one direction stay constant and one of them go to zero? Wouldn't that also possibly have a finite volume?
Yeah.
So they don't both have to go to zero necessarily, right?
No. No, it just this happens to go to zero. But it could go to some constant, that's fine too. Right?
Well, I mean, I did just. Both of them are constant, you would get infinite volume.
I'm sorry?
If both of them are constant, it's a constant.
Before or after integrating?
If just the limit of the. You know, if they,
you mean the integrand? This part?
No, if how you said just there has to close in on that.
Well, it doesn't have to close in on the origin, it could be over here.
Okay,
it has to close in on the place where it blows up.
But couldn't one of them stay constant?
One of them could stay constant and you could close in on a...
Okay.
Sure. So let me do one more example. So, I mean, you just have to take care that you're taking the appropriate limit. You have to think about where it's blowing up and you have to take the limit as it blows up in the right way. Right? So you could just as well take... You know, we could certainly do... Something like, so it is, 2, it's 10 to 3 in the morning in India right now, so, I've lost track. Okay, so if we had something like, let's just do something, this is y. So if we had something that was this, I don't know if you can see this picture, I know what I'm drawing. This is the function f of x, y is just 1 over y squared. Well, actually, yeah, sure. And let's just go off to infinity. Then certainly we can just take the limit as y squared goes to infinity. So this doesn't come down to a point, but okay. Or I could try and find, you know, this other one where I get a whole line, and that would be fine too. So yeah, you can do that. You just have to think about what's blowing up and what's the shape of what's blowing up, and then you have to take the appropriate limit. So let me do one other example. I don't know if you know that this is true. But this is a true fact. Which, as opposed to a false fact, this is an actual fact. It's a true thing. Which is saying that if we take the bell curve, which is important in statistics, and we don't normalize it, then the area under it, from plus infinity to minus infinity, is the square root of pi. Now, you can't really do this integral in one variable, because you can't make a substitution to turn this into something in a nice form. But we can be tricky. Instead of doing this, so how do we do this? Well, surprisingly, this is hard to calculate, but this is easy to calculate, which is somewhat surprising, but you have to be a little bit tricky. So we have to view this as saying, if we look on any square in the xy plane, we put a finite bump, so this bumps both ways, right? So I'm taking the square and I'm lifting it up. Like that. I'm taking the square and I'm pinching it up in the middle. And this square goes, I don't know, from minus m to m in all directions. Then the volume of this is that. Well, so the volume of this guy is equal to this. Which is the same as if I integrate, let's just say, over the reals, over the whole plane, of e to the minus x squared minus y squared, d, let's do it, dx. Is that clear that it is? Yes, no, maybe?
Yes.
So, this thing is perfectly symmetrical, so that if I cut this in half, that'll give me the area in one direction, and then if I square it, it'll give me the area in the other direction. So the product of those two areas will give me the area of this volume, because of this, the xy symmetry in this. So that's why the square is the same as if I write this as a double integral over x and y. And I have to integrate it over the whole plane, because it's going off all the way out. But this integral is easy. Maybe it doesn't look so easy right here, but this is the same thing as if I integrate in polar coordinates over the whole plane,
that's
e to the minus r squared, r dr d theta. Polar coordinates are magic. In this case, instead of having this square thing, I have a hat. A hat for somebody who really needs a lot of shade. This is a really big sombrero. So, yeah.
Is that square root for negative for minus y squared?
Yeah, it's negative x squared plus y squared.
Sombrero for all of us.
I could see
here. Yeah. So, if I make this is a really big sombrero, right? The brim goes out to infinity in both cases. But now I'm integrating over a circle, or a disk. So then this becomes a lot easier. This is an easy integral now, right? So if we write it in polar coordinates, theta goes from 0 to 2 pi, r goes from 0 to some big number, e to the minus r squared r dr d theta, and then we take the limit as r goes to infinity. That's a big r and that's a little r. And this integral, we make the substitution u equals negative r squared. So du is, let's do plus r, is 2r dr. And so this is integral from 0 to 2 pi, and as u equals 0 means that r equals 0 and r equals big R means that u equals big thing. What is it? Square root? Anyway. So this is the same as the integral limit as r goes to infinity, I guess. What is that?
Square root?
Square root of r.
Square root of r. It's somewhat less big.
0 e to the minus u du d theta. 1 half. Okay, now I'm falling asleep. This is then 2 pi limit as r goes to infinity of minus e to the minus u from 0 to square root of r, which is, well, it doesn't matter. That goes to infinity, so that's 1, and that's 1, right? Yes?
I'm
So this is 2 pi times 1 minus 0, minus 1, which is 2 pi. I lost a half. Which is pi. So the square of the integral is pi. The integral is square root of pi. Yeah?
I don't think it's important, but I just really get why e to the negative x squared integral squared is equal to the cross section of e to the negative x squared plus pi squared.
But you don't understand why that integral is the square?
Yeah.
Okay.
Because I try to put like an arbitrary three-dimensional object. And
no, it needs symmetry.
Or no, an arbitrary symmetrical.
Quadrero.
Okay.
quadrera?
What? It's a quadrero. It's a square somewhere. Okay. So I'm done with that. Unless you need more. So now I want to move on from this stuff. Are we okay with? So improper integrals are exactly the same, but you have a few more tricks you can play because you have more dimensions to play with. So in sometimes you can do things in multiple dimensions that you can't do in one. Okay, so now put that away. We move on to the next big section of the class. The fourth third of the class. Okay, so we talked a little while ago. So this is a big changing topic now. We have some function from Rn to Rn. And we can view this in two ways. Let me do it in the case where n is 2 because it's easier to draw. We can think of take this as taking something in the xy plane, applying f to it, and getting, that's supposed to be a, let's try it again. So that f takes an area in the plane and does something to it, gives us another area in the plane. This is one way that we can think of a function of two variables. And another way that we saw, these are not going to be the same f because I don't think I can draw that one. Maybe I can. No. Or as a vector field. So different f, so let's call it g. Where at each point, p, we attach a vector g of p. So we get a field of arrows in the field, right? So think of a function of several variables in either way. And depending on the context, one is more appropriate than the other. But they're really the same thing. I mean, to try and turn this picture into a vector field picture, I would superimpose this. So let me see if I can. So this one backs up a little bit. No, they all point to the right. So I have sort of little arrows here. And here I have great big arrows. That would be the vector field, of course. Let me not put it in the same. So f as a vector field would look something like this. Something like that, right? Because these points go very far, so they have big arrows attached. These points move a little bit, so they have little arrows attached. Right? I would attach this arrow to this point. Does this make sense? Yes? No? Anyway, it's not really productive to try and switch back and forth between the two representations. Just think of the one that's appropriate for what you're doing. So now we're going to focus on calculus related to vector fields for essentially the rest of the class. And these are particularly relevant for things like physics, but a lot of applications. So, imagine I want to represent, I don't know, fluid flow or forces, some kind of forces, then a vector field is a particularly appropriate way to represent these kind of things. Now, we did a little bit with vector fields, but now we'll do more. So suppose that I have some function, and I'm going to write n, but I'm always going to draw 2. And I have some vector field here about this one, or use this one. So this one that I'm drawing, something like that. So that's f of x, y is negative 1, x. Is that right? No, it's x negative 1. So at when x is 0, the vectors just point down. They're actually longer. They point all the way down to the origin, but I shortened them. When y is 0, the vectors point away. When we're somewhere in between, we get this kind of a relationship, right? Is this confusing to anybody? We talked about these a little bit before. We're good with this? All right. So now imagine that we have some path. Matter, but I have some path here. So this is going to start here and go there. Let's call it gamma. And I want to compute what is the value of this vector field. What is the total behavior of this vector field as I move along the path? So for example, you could imagine that this vector field represents, I don't know, some collection of forces. Maybe it's, well, some collection of forces. And I want to move something along this path from here to here. How much total force did it need? How much total force did it feel as I moved along this path? Right? Well, so since I want total force, this means it's going to be some kind of integral. How much is the total? Well, we have to sort of project these vectors onto that path. So I'll come back to this sort of interpretation in a second, or we can just define it as some abstract object. But this is really what it is. So if I look at this curve gamma, so gamma is some, I don't really want an integral. Sorry. So g is a function, sorry, it's a path, so it starts in R. Right, G is some curve from R to Rn, where here T has got some range. And if I look at the tangent vectors to this G, here's my G, it has tangent vectors so the tangents to g at any point t are just g prime of t. This is what we did in the very beginning. Right? So if I start at this point, t equals, I don't know, 1/2, well, okay, sure. Then the tangent vector here will be g prime of 1/2. And I should have drawn it in red, but I didn't. And we can calculate if I have, so really this one should be red. Let me make it red again. At the point 1/2, how is my vector field? Leave enough room. Here's my vector field. And what is the effect of this vector field when I'm moving that way. Well, in this picture, they're basically perpendicular, so you don't feel any of that force. Just like force of gravity is straight down, if there's no friction, I can move in this way with no work. But if I want to move this way, it's a lot harder. Whereas someplace here, then I need to project this onto that to feel how much it is, right? And so I want to add up one aught. So if I have some parameterization of a curve, I can compute this integral. So did I have an example I was going to do? Yeah, sure. So let's do that example. It's not quite good. So suppose my function is that one. And my curve is going to be a piece of a parabola so I have this vector field. And I'm going to calculate the line integral over this chunk of the parabola. And I'm parameterizing it exactly this way. So I'm not worrying about whether I'm traversing it in unit speed or anything like that. Okay? So I can just calculate this integral. So the integral from 0 to 1 of f of g of t dotted with g prime of t dt, well, I have to calculate what g prime of t is, and I have to calculate what f of g of t is, but that's pretty easy. So if I plug t's in here, then f of g of t is t minus t squared, and the derivative of g of t is 1 to t. And so that is t minus 2t cubed dt, which is easy to do now. So this is t squared over 2 minus 2 thirds, no, 1 half t to the fourth from 0 to 1, which is a half minus a half, which is nothing. Guess so. Okay, so why is that? That's kind of surprising that it's nothing. Well, everybody sees why it's nothing. Why is it nothing?
It has to be that the vector field is orthogonal to the curve.
Right, so this vector field is exactly orthogonal to that parabola and some other color. So. Okay. Of course, if I change this curve to be something else, then I won't necessarily get zero. Right? For example, if I change this to be, I don't know, just a diagonal line, well, that should also be zero. If I integrate just along the x-axis, then I'll get. So now this is not really what we want to. Okay, if we want to interpret this as a physical thing, well, you know, we really should, if I want to, this parameterization is not of unit speed, and so when I'm calculating the dot product of f and g prime, I'm not projecting those vectors in there, right? I have to divide by the length of the vector. So if I really want to calculate, say, work, so that is the effect, so I have my curve gamma, and I have my vector here, and I want to calculate what is the contribution of this onto that, then I want this to be a unit vector. Because I want to calculate the contributions without being messed up by the speed of gamma. Right? Certainly, I mean, if I had chosen a little better here, so suppose that let's say the integral from a to b of f of g of t dot g prime of t dt is some number, 2. And then I look at then I look at something that goes twice as fast. Well, that's not clear. So, really what I want in order to do work is that I want g prime of t to always be a unit vector. So I want gamma to be parameterized by Parkland. Maybe long ago. So I'd like g prime of t to always be a unit vector, because then the length of the tangent won't have a contribution. And the usual So the usual notation for this is we call that S. I'm sorry. So that's not a delta, that's an S. So what we really want is f ds. It's dt over g prime of t. That will make it be a unit.
I guess there should be a g of t in there too.
We want to divide through to make it be units. I'm sorry?
Maybe g prime.
Yeah, I want these to be unit. So I take any parameterization, and I just
think that the numerator is g of
g prime g of g. All right. So this one's a little bit messed up, but it doesn't matter, in the sense that this is not, there's a corner, right? In the x and y, we're fine. Let me try and draw g. So cosine, sine, and this guy, when t is less than pi over 2, it just increases from 0.
when t is less than pi over 2, yeah, I go from pi over 2 down to 0. So it starts here, goes down to 0 at pi over 2, and then it's supposed to be a straight line. So this sits over the circle in the plane. That doesn't look like a circle in the plane. Okay, so this guy sits over this circle. He starts at height pi over 2 up here, and as we go on the circle, it comes down, let me draw it wrong, like that. And then it bounces off and goes back up. Except this is sitting over the circle. Does that make any sense? Nobody has a clue what I'm trying to draw? Okay. Here is the graph of t minus pi over 2 absolute value. It looks like that. Okay? And now I'm trying to put this onto this cylinder, but it starts here, it goes down, and it has a corner here, and it goes back up the other side. Okay, there's a corner here, right? It's this sharp corner. So, in particular, g prime of pi over 2 doesn't exist.
Pi over 2 minus t, is t increasing on the x-axis? On the absolute value of t minus pi, like why is it going down first?
Well, because I'm stupid. Minus, but no, absolute value of minus pi over 2 is pi over 2.
Yeah.
And then t, yeah. Well, it doesn't matter. It doesn't matter, because it's so if you prefer, you can write it this way. Because it's absolute value.
Because it goes down at first.
It goes down until we get to pi over 2, and then it turns around. Right? This is the same as pi over 2 minus t if t is less than pi over 2, and t minus pi over 2 if t is bigger than pi over 2.
Yeah.
Right? So this one goes down, this one goes up. So if you want to write it that way or that way, because it's absolute value, it doesn't care. Okay, so what was I doing with this? I don't know. So if we wanted to compute, but notice that g prime, well, let's see, so what's g prime of t? This will be minus sine t, cosine t, and then even plus or minus 1 if t isn't pi over 2. So it'll be minus 1 when t, let's just write it separately. So this is t less than pi over 2. Not defined if t equals pi over 2. So if I wanted, I don't want to use my voice. If I wanted to calculate now the work here, so what's the length of this? Well, this is norm g prime of t is square root sine square plus cosine square plus 1 plus square root 2. In both cases, as long as we're not at pi over 2. So this is almost parameterized by arc length. I just have to divide by root 2. Then it'll be parameterized by arc. So if I want to compute this, I have good derivative there. But in fact, it doesn't matter. So this will be, what was that, xyz?
Yeah.
Which is cosine, sine, this thing. Well, let's just, this is going to be cosine t, sine t, pi over 2 minus t, dotted with I've lost it. Minus sine t, cosine t, pi over 2 minus t.
Wait, no.
So is this the derivative?
This derivative?
Yes.
Oh, this one. Thank you. Depending on which piece it is, which will be negative sine cosine plus sine cosine. So this will just be the integral from 0 to pi, and pi over 2 minus t, 1 over square root of 2. Right? But that's it.
Yeah,
it can't
be zero.
It's not zero.
It should be two times.
It's, yeah.
It's
the base is pi over 2, and the height is pi over 2, so it's pi squared over 4. Right? They have a triangle and another triangle. Flop it over to the square. Okay, so anyway, we can do it. So what was the point of this? The point of this is these are easy to do, provided that the parameterization is nice. And it doesn't matter if it's messed up at one point. You can just split it up, it's okay. Just like regular integrals, if they're messed up at one point, break them up, it doesn't matter that there's no derivative at one point because it's just one point and we're integrating. Okay, but there was something, yeah.
What if the value of absolute value of g quantity is not a constant?
Then you have to work harder.
So I just divide it.
So if the length is not constant, then you have to adjust g to make it nicer. So you have to work harder. You have to parameterize it so that the thing does have a constant, which sometimes kind of sucks. Okay, so I did that already. I guess I want to, so I want to point out some notation that one encounters. Yeah, and then I'll do that other thing. So if I have,
that's not it. Where'd it go?
There. Okay. So suppose I have an integral, one of these line integrals. I have something like that. And I think that, let's do it in I don't know, R3. So f it has three components. Functions, which give me the x, the y, and the z components. In general, I'll have n such things. And Well, I can think that G x of t, y of t, z of t, and then I'll just sort of suppress the of t. Right? So this is just, I'm going to break up my g into three component functions, g1, g2, g3, but I'm going to call them x of t, y of t, z of t. So this, I can rewrite. Let me do it in a couple of steps. F So a lot of times you see this kind of notation. Or sometimes you even just see this as this. Maybe dx. So a lot of times you'll see things that don't seem to make sense.
Great.
Right, so you might see integrals like p dy plus q, oops, p dx plus q dy. How many people have seen these kind of things in, say, physics? There's a couple of physics people here. So this is just representing a line integral in a slightly different notation, right? This is really, you want to parameterize this function and then split it out. And maybe over some curve, yeah. So you see these kind of notations. I still have 10 minutes, but. Notice is that we don't really have to worry about so these kind of things don't really depend on the parameterization of gamma, provided that I don't do something stupid like make it run the other way. So it doesn't really matter whether gamma goes fast or slow, because, yeah, I'm not going to make it if I do that. So what does that mean? Equivalent parameterizations of gamma. So that is, if I have, say, gamma parameterized as, g of t, and I have some other parameterization, call it h of t, u. So these both represent the same curve, where say du dt is always the same sign. I guess I need it bigger than zero. Right, I can write the curve by two different parameterizations, and the derivative of this variable with respect to that variable is positive. And it's not zero. Then I'll get the same answer when I do these integrals, because I'm just going to make a substitution. Right? So that means I have some u of t. I'm going to make the substitution u of t. Is this clear, or should I write this out?
Do you have an example?
Well, let me do the proof. The proof is shorter than the example. So,
no matter what g is, I see that it must be part of the same.
It cancels out. So, I mean, a priori we want it to be unit speed, but in fact, it doesn't matter. And we can use these kind of things. So let's see what that is. So I have, this would be, so let's just start with this one and go to that one. So I have the integral of f of g of t, g prime of t, dt, as t goes from a to b. So that's this. But I'm going to make the substitution u of t. T is some how about this? T is some phi of u. Right? So this would be state it, and then I guess I'll prove it, even though it's easy. So remember, in one variable, suppose that we have, let me just write it this way. The integral from a to b of d dt of f of x. So I take the derivative of some function and I integrate it, then this is just the same as plugging in at either end. This is the ordinary fundamental theorem of calculus. That's how I integrate x. I find a function that it's the derivative of, and I evaluate it at either end. The integral of 2x from 2 to 3 is I find out that x squared, the derivative of x squared is 2x, and I evaluate it from 2 to 3, and I get 9 minus 4 is 5. Because 2x is dx squared. Okay, something similar goes on here. These line integrals don't depend on gamma if the thing that we're integrating, so if f is the gradient of some function f, little f. Maybe I should use one of them as g. I don't know. So if my function that I'm integrating is the gradient of some other function, let's call it p for potential, then the integral of f dot dx over some curve gamma is just gamma at one end minus gamma at the other end. So if we get not every function is the gradient of some other function, but if it is, then these are particularly easy. So sometimes this is called independence of path. So let me just say this. Okay. Another way to say this, so in this case, this is called a conservative vector field. And so another way to say this theorem, which is the fundamental theorem of calculus, says that if f is a conservative vector field, it is independent of a path. Yeah. And I think I'm out of time. Yeah.
So does that mean it's a state, like a state function?
If it's what?
Would you consider like a state function? Maybe it's a different subject.
So a conservative vector field means you have a potential. You have a quantity which is preserved. So for example, in a physical system with no friction.
Yeah.
Right?
Okay.
So if we have friction, then it's dissipative and it does depend.
I have
or can't. Let me stop there.